Modeling with modifiers will only take you so far. Ultimately, you want more control over your models in a way that resembles sculpting. For that, you need polymodeling. This method of modeling starts with a simple primitive object, so you need modeling tools to let you shape the surface. In this lesson, we'll introduce a number of modeling tools, then set to work using them on a model in the next lesson. Let's start by creating a box. Go to the Create panel, Geometry, Box. Click and drag to draw out the box. Then in the Modify panel, set the length, width, and height values all to an even 20 units to make a perfect cube. You need to convert the primitives to an editable object so that the sub-object modes like vertices and polygons can be accessed and manipulated. There are a few ways to convert your object to an editable polygon. First, you can access Convert to Poly through the Modeling ribbon. Also, the right-click menu or the Modify panel by right-clicking in the stack. This lesson focuses on using the tools in the Modeling ribbon. Also, turn on your edge faces using the shortcut F4. Once you convert your model, you'll have many options for accessing the sub-object modes. The most common way is to use the buttons in the ribbon modeling panel, or the Modify panel. Or you can right-click for the quad menu under the Tools 1 section. Lastly, you can use the keyboard shortcuts, 1 for vertex, 2 for edge, 3 for borders, 4 for polygon, 5 for element. Basically, a sub-object is the underlining geometry that can be edited on a 3D mesh. An editable polygon has 5 sub-object modes available. Vertex is a simple point in space. An edge is a line connecting two vertices, which forms a side of a polygon. A border is generally the edges around a hole in an object. A polygon is a closed sequence of 3 or more edges forming a surface. And finally, the element subobject allows you to select and edit groups of contiguous polygons. The edge between two vertices is always straight. To curve or bend a surface, you must add more detail by subdividing the polygons, creating more vertices and edges. These additional vertices can be moved to create a faceted curvature from what used to be straight. The more facets or subdivisions you have, the smoother and more detailed the curvature of the model can be, ultimately giving you more flexibility in shaping your model. You can shape your model in many ways using subobjects. Let's start at the polygon subobject level to explore some modeling tools. I'll select a polygon on this model. In the ribbon polygons panel, I'll select the extrude button. Back to the selected polygon on the model, and with a simple click and drag, extrude lets you push or pull the selected polygon in a direction perpendicular to its current orientation. This is not merely moving the polygon, it's actually adding more geometry to the object along the extrusion. Once you have extruded it, you can move, rotate, or scale the extruded polygon any way you like to further shape the object. The bevel mode is like the extrude mode, but it also lets you scale the extrusion for a more interesting effect. This means that in bevel mode, you drag a selected polygon to extrude it, but then when you release the mouse button, you can move the mouse further to scale the polygon to your liking. Just click to release. This is quite a handy tool. Extrusions and bevels can also be used to punch holes in geometry by pushing the extrusion into the object. This is especially useful if you combine it with inset. The inset command is essentially a bevel, but without the extrusion. It's great for creating quads while retaining the object shape. Once you created the inset polygon, you can then extrude or bevel as well, giving you finer control than just extrude or bevel alone. These tools offer different ways to achieve the look you need for your model, giving you freedom in figuring out your own workflow. Let's talk about duplicating geometry. I'm going to select these parts of an object in element mode. Then I will shift drag to duplicate the selected polygons. You'll want to select clone to element to keep these duplicated polygons as part of the same object. Then click OK. When you select two polygons that face each other, you can click bridge to create polygons that span the gap between them. When working at the sub-object level, it's important to be able to select efficiently. For example, ring selects all the edges parallel to the selected one, and loop selects all connected edges by their endpoints. The loop is lost, however, when it encounters a five-edged vertex, as you see here. You can also double-click an edge to select a loop, or select an edge, then shift-click on the next parallel edge, and this will select the ring of edges. With the ring of edges still selected, look at the Connect and Connect Settings commands. Click the Connect button to connect all selected edges with an additional edge. Vertices are added where the edges cross. Better yet, press Ctrl-Z to undo this and click the Connect Settings button by clicking on the arrow next to the Connect button. In the caddy that appears, you can specify the number of edges you want to create. You can also pinch them and slide them to get the new edges where you need them. Once you're done, you can click the check mark to accept the changes and close the caddy. As you just saw, the Connect tool has extra settings. Many other tools have the same when you use their settings. Another useful tool is Chamfer. Chamfer is most commonly used on edges, as it's an effective way of creating a beveled corner. Chamfer corners add a level of detail to a model and help edges and corners catch light better. Chamfer also works at the vertex sub-object level too. Another helpful feature set are the use of constraints, which are in the Edit panel. They let you use existing geometry to constrain sub-object transformation to make shaping a model easier. There are three types: constrained to edge, constrained to face, and constrained to normal. For instance, I will enable constrained to edge and then move this vertex, and it will only move along an edge. Just remember to turn off the option as soon as you've finished with it, or it may cause problems later. You can select two or more vertices and weld them together. Select multiple vertices and then open Weld Settings Caddy. Then specify a threshold value. This will draw together and weld those vertices into one vertex. Another more interactive way to weld vertices together is to use the target weld mode, where you force a vertex to weld onto another by clicking and dragging from one to the other. Since shaping a model requires subdivisions or vertices and edges to manipulate, in the Edit panel, you can turn on the Swift Loop to add edges and vertices exactly where you want them. Swift Loop creates edge loops, which are a series of continuous edges on the surface of an object. As you model and subdivide, here are some guidelines to keep in mind for a cleaner workflow. When subdividing and creating polygons, it's best to create the polygons to have four sides, making them quads, whenever possible, to create a clean model. Additionally, you'll want to create smoothly flowing edge loops in an even grid pattern as much as possible. These guidelines are especially important when creating curved surfaces and areas that bend during animation, such as with a character. Otherwise, you can end up with unpredictable smoothing and smoothing artifacts such as bumps and holes. Creating an even mesh is also important for unwrapping, rigging, animation, and so on. The next lesson describes how to build a bench seat using the techniques introduced in this lesson.